said, approximately, right, you can raise the allocation factor, meaning to pack well only. You can make a flat number, we'll be able to, and you can test the general work order. You can have a town as well, you can reach me over the internet, my email, but we should deliver in time. So, I just want you to keep this information in mind so you know how to reach us.
Says they were holding me and guided by the Holy Spirit.
kind of prayer for you and I have today, now, that is not something that is of no importance. You might be saying, yada, 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 but really, it is something very important. Return us home. That's why we put so much emphasis on reality, the body, the word of truth. Now, when God said that we should ride in the body, the word of truth, stand to show thyself approved unto God. A word that need not be said, ride in the body, the word of truth. He wasn't just talking. He wasn't just saying that just to hear himself talk, or he wasn't saying that just so the apostle Paul would have something to write. He wasn't just saying that simply because he wanted some filler. You know that he had a certain amount of manuscript that he had to fill up. He was saying it for a reason. We are supposed to rally by the word truth to show ourselves approved unto God. And so when God said, rally by the word truth, he wasn't saying, yada, yada, yada. He was actually saying something very, very important. He was actually saying, now, wait a minute. You say, what about it? You say, yada, 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 means it's not really important. And then you're telling us that God says that we should yada, yada, yada when it comes to studying the Scripture. And you're telling me that we are to yada, yada, yada? That's exactly right. Not yada, yada, yada in the sense of it's not important, but yada, yada, yada in the sense of that it is important. God said that the priest's job was to teach the people. And notice this. They shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the profane and cause them to discern between the clean, the unclean, and the clean. Cause them to discern yada. You see? It's not yada, yada, yada like we use today. Somebody has a way of saying, well, it's not important. But he says, they need to discern. They have an obligation to make a difference, to know, to scrutinize, to be able to tell what is right and what is wrong. And that's it. He wants us to yada. He wants us to know the difference. You see? Satan said this to Eve as he was tempting her. He said that God knows that in the day you eat thereof, in the day that ye thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. You will be able to discern between what is good and what is evil. And I'll tell you, friends, that is why we stress studying God's word so much. It's because it's important. It's important that we study God's word so that we know how to discern between what is good and what is evil. Notice this in 1 Thessalonians 5:21. What about that? Paul said that we are to do something in a way that requires making a decision. Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. You have to make a discern. You have to discern what is right, what is wrong, what is good, and what is evil. And then hold that which is good. But you can't do that if you simply look at studying God's word and have an attitude of, yada, yada, yada. It doesn't make any difference. Not a big deal, not important. But you can prove all things and hold fast that which is good if you are yada, yada, yada. If you're discerning. If you are discerning between good and evil and discerning what God has to say, then you'll be able to say that this is right and this is wrong. Jude used another word. Jude, of course, this is an Old Testament word, but Jude used a word in Jude 22, don't ask me what chapter. He says, of some having the passion, making a difference. Now, here's the meaning of this phrase that Jude uses. Jude says, to make a difference. In other words, to separate thoroughly, to withdraw from or to oppose, to hesitate, discern between good and evil with you, you won't be able to determine from the word of God. No. You have to have some exercise. Look at it in Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 12. Verse 12, Paul says, "For when the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again the first which be the first fruit of the Lord was God, and are become as such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe." A child, a babe, is unskillful in the word. Why? He hasn't yada, yada, yada. He hasn't discerned. He doesn't exercise his ability to discern between right and wrong. The strong meat belongs to men which are full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. In other words, they have made an effort to discern right and wrong, good and evil. They didn't look at it like, well, there's no biggie. That's what Paul was actually criticizing them for, chastising for. There ought to be a time when you ought to be teaching someone. But instead, the way you have approached learning the word of God, you've approached it like yada, 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 like it's no big deal. But really, what you ought to be doing is yada, 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 the same. You see how it is? And so, that's why, friends, we are always stressing you need to know how to write and write the word of truth. Make sure that what you believe from God's word does not contradict what else is written in the word of God. Jesus used way of demonstrating the word of God to the devil when he said it's written again. See, we're trying to get you to find out what is it written again. Is it the case that what I believe is contradicted by something else? It's what I believe to be true, actually contradicted in the Bible, so that it can't be right. The other day I was talking to a man, a Mason, over here tonight, and he said, "What, do you believe John 3:16? "Yeah, I believe John 3:16. I said, "Do you believe Acts 2:38 and Acts 1:16, when it says, "Be baptized and wash away your sins," or "Be baptized for the remission of sins"? He said, "Well, you don't believe John 3:16. Why can't you believe both of them? Why can't you accept the fact? Why can't you accept the fact that truth is not always in just one verse? That there may be something else that will give you more truth." And the reason why all of you folks out there who always just hold up John 3:16 as the only verse of the Bible about salvation, because you have it yada yada yada, you have it designed. You have to exercise, you have to go through the effort to determine what is right, what is wrong, what is good and what is evil, what is true, what is not true, and therefore you have to be approached that he does what he does. But we're always stressing, not only what the will of God is, but making sure that you know what is right and what is wrong. That's where we are. See, notice this. In Romans 4, verse 20, here's how the same word that you did use, 22, is used. It's used in reference to Abraham. And on this occasion, it says Abraham didn't do this. It says Abraham didn't do this. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. That word staggered is make a difference. He didn't hesitate. He didn't discriminate. He didn't falter. He didn't waver when it came to believing what God said. That God was able to do what he said he would do. He didn't stagger. But there's sometimes, friends, there's sometimes when you need to stagger. You need to stop. You need to hesitate. You need to wait. You need to stop, look, and listen. Because you need to make sure that what you're believing is not contradicting what the Bible says in other areas. That's what we're dealing with. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about staggering, hesitating, because it may be believing something that's not even known. It's because you haven't discerned between what is right and wrong, what is good and evil. You haven't discerned if really what you believe what in private would have done. Listen, we live in a society that everybody's talking about discriminating. You can't discriminate. You can't discriminate. You know what? God says we shouldn't discriminate. We should discriminate and make a determination. This is right and this is wrong. And the only way you want to do it is to crack open the book and figure out if everything you do is consistent. I can assure you, friends, I told you to say, you go to a Bible-believing church. And those of you who say, well, oh, my preacher, he preaches right out of the Bible. You haven't discerned. You haven't discerned what the Bible says, because you wouldn't say that you're in a Baptist church and you believe the whole Bible, and that your preacher preaches right out of the Bible, but you're in a church that's not even in the Bible. That just means you have a pro study of the Bible, like yada, 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 when really, what you ought to have done is a pro ask God. You should have approached it in a very discerning, in a distinctive way. You should have been able to make a difference. You need to judge between. And that's what God is telling us. We need to know how to judge between, and we need to know what is right and what is wrong, so that we can make a difference. So that we can determine what God wants and what He doesn't want. I want to tell you this. See if you hear what he says. He actually used the term difference. Well, there's a difference between, but the problem is he hasn't discerned correctly. He hasn't made the right difference in the things that he said. This is what he says.
You don't work more than the program. I'm doing well.
is, should be one way when it's in the church building and you're all together assembled in one place at the church. 1 Corinthians 11. You know, you're all together in one place. All right, it matters there. But then he says, well, it doesn't matter when you're not over here. There's no difference in the place. God says that if you worship him in song, there is a way. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter where you are. God has said how he won't sing songs of praise to him done. And it's not one way in the corporate worship and another way at home or when you're by yourself trying to look over. It's always the same way. Look at this. Hebrews 13, verse 15. And him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God, only in corporate worship, but not going home. No, continually. Every time you worship God in song, that's how he wants it done. You're on the work of the Lord. Says is he wants the fruit of our lips continually. Now, if you worship God and over here in your garage at home and you start singing a song of praise, then what you realize is, hey, you know, God has told me how he wants me to sing a song of praise, and it is the fruit of my lips. You know, not the fingers on my lips. You know, he wants the fruit of my lips. That's the thing we're struggling with last week, even when we are, a couple weeks ago, when we were having this same discussion. Explain to us, you can give us a book, chapter, verse, time outside the corporate worship. And you just, you can't discern, you can't show where there is a difference. So you're making a difference where there is no difference. And that's the part of what I'm saying, that
I don't think you make the difference.
you bring what do you bring up? Do you use what the application needs to go for the avenue on Wednesday? The avenue on Wednesday night? Do you bring what the application needs to go for? And God said,
no.
Well, God didn't say anything about Wednesday night. Well, God didn't know.
Yeah.
they sang praise before the God. And what? You took a 10-minute intro. He had it in prison. You know, that's right. That's exactly right. You know why? Because they didn't get hold of one when they went to church. When they went to the temple, you know, they didn't have one. You see that view? God's commandment. God says, worship me in such a way that even if you're in prison, you can still worship me. It's not that the church cries to be like individual music. If we want to be in it, we can be like everybody else. We'll have to be in trouble. You know, $99 band and we got one. We're $2 band in the music store. But we don't have intimate music in our worship. Why? It's not what God commanded. And it's not really what it's not what we need. All we need is the fruit of our lips. All right, John, you're one about that.
I'm going to put it.
shall be the holy anointed pool unto me throughout all generations. Upon man's flesh shall it not be poured, neither shall ye make any other like it after the composition of it. It is holy, it shall be holy unto you. Whosoever compoundeth any like it, or whosoever putteth any of it upon a stranger, shall either be cut off from his people. My friends, look, God said this particular oil is used for the anointing of the priest. No one else uses it. You don't use it in a common fashion. My friends, why would we suspect that God would accept Psalms, you know, the spirit of Psalms, being sung to him, being accept Psalms, you know, Psalms sung to him, but our mission over here with all this hip hop, punk rock, jib jab, jumping and carrying on foolishness? Why would he accept something that's mixed with worldly music that you never have to write? Because you don't need to have what is holy and go over here and visit what is profane and say God's not accepted. Now that's the principle that we have to get across. And the reason why individuals are having so much trouble with that, and why you see so much so-called Christian rock and Christian hip-hop and Christian rap and Christian this and that, is because people have not been discerning. Remember what we talked about at the beginning? They have approached finding out what God wants with the attitude of yada, 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 instead of yada, 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 discern, discern, discern. So, remember Ezekiel, let me get back where I'm out of time, but let me see if I can get back to this. Remember this